started, and there are ET alums, and they've got a really cool startup that they're jamming on right now. And so just in the spirit of, we've done with a lot of other classes, I think it's always good to get you hearing real-world examples from other students that have kind of come through this process, some much further down the line, and some maybe a little earlier. And so very last minute, asked him to come in today, and he very graciously accepted. So we're just going to do a quick kind of 10 minutes of his story, and then give you guys a chance to ask questions too.
Awesome. Thanks, Josh. I'm Jagath. I'm the founder of Ordoro. So what we do is we are an e-commerce app for small businesses. We're named as one of the top 10 hottest startups in Austin a couple of weeks ago by Giga Own. We had a lot of traffic, foot traffic, real people coming into our office and doing supplies over there. Huge. Let me tell you what exactly the product does. It's a web app and it's targeting small businesses, right? So if you're a small business and you're selling online, you're most likely selling on Amazon Marketplace, on eBay, on buy.com, or you probably have websites built on like Shopify or WooCommerce or one of these web store platforms. Once you start selling on all these places, now you have like data all over the place. When a customer calls you asking for an order, you got to go visit all these different places. When you sell one unit on one website, the other website doesn't know that you have less installed. So you're constantly juggling with a lot of information. So that's a problem that we solve very nicely. So we would plug it into your Shopify store, into your Amazon, into your buy.com, aggregate everything in one place, keep inventory in sync. When you sell in one place, we go update the numbers in the other place and all that. The second big problem that we solve is this idea of dropshipping. So if you're a small business, you're most likely, you're listing, let's say, 10,000 products on your website. You probably have only like 2,000 of them in your warehouse. The remaining ones, you're just listing your supplier's products. And what you do is when someone buys from your website, you would just call your supplier or email them and tell them that, hey, please ship this product to this address. This is called dropshipping, and people do that because you don't have to buy all that inventory upfront and sink all your cash. For small businesses, cash that you receive, dropshipping is very popular in small business world, and our app really does that very elementary. So you would define a set of rules saying that this product is shipped from this guy's warehouse. When an order comes in, you would automatically notify them and keep that quality. So this is just a couple of things that we do. And it's a software as a service model. People just come and sign up. The price point ranges from like $40 a month to more than $500 a month. We released our app about 11 months ago, and we're seeing a lot of good traction now. We're getting like, we have more than 1,000 people who are signed up and using our software. A good percentage of them are paying. Each customer pays on average more than $100 a month. So it's picking up pretty good. It's a small company, it's just 6 people. There were like 4 of us as founders, and we just hired 2 more people in January. And we are actually going to make 2 more hires now. We are hiring a developer and someone to deal with our customer support angles. So that's in a nutshell of what the product does. To tell you a little bit about the story of the company. So I graduated from McCombs MBA program a couple of years ago, and I started this company along with my co-founders while I was in school. So my background is I worked for about 8 years before I came for MBA. I have an undergraduate in engineering. Then I started working for a company in Dallas called I2. It is supply chain management consulting for large companies. So I started off as a software product manager, then moved out into consulting world. I was traveling around the world, going to big companies like GM, Chrysler, Airbus, the Corona beer company, trying to solve their inventory management, order management problem. It's kind of boring enterprise-y stuff, but there was a lot of money in that. The company itself was doing pretty good. I did that for about 8 years, really got tired of consulting and the big corporate world and said that, okay, I got to get out of this. Always wanted to start my own business. And I also wanted to do an MBA around that time, so I just said that I quit that, came back to UT full time. And one of the things that happened was, I think it was the first or second semester, that the MBA program gives you this opportunity to work with a lot of different businesses while you're in school as a side project. You know, it's not done for credit. I think it's called the Graduate Plus program. So I met a small business owner in town as part of that. Basically, he was a child psychologist, and he started. So his story was that he treats children who have problems adjusting to social situations, and they use a bunch of like non-branded toys. So rather than using a Barbie, he would just have a generic doll figure. He would use that to diagnose issues. So he really wanted to thought that, okay, if I couldn't find them easily, there are a lot of child psychologists out there who probably are not finding this easily. So he started doing a bunch of research, and he started this business of selling these toys online. It's called childtherapytoys.com. And his business started doing well. I think in about 2 years, he hit like $1 million in revenue. And he had never run a business before. He didn't know how what he was doing. So he came to school and said that, hey, I'm a doctor, but I'm not a business guy. Can you guys help me really like review the business and help me figure out what I'm doing wrong, what I can be doing better? I really found the project very interesting and decided to work with him. And it's during that time that I realized that a lot of stuff that I was telling the big businesses, this guy has a lot of the same problems. Not at the same scale, it's a different, the problems are, it's a different nature, but fundamentally it's the same thing. He didn't know what product to stock, he didn't know how many units of what to stock. His warehouse was like, there was a lot of Excel spreadsheeting and like email, for example, his entire customer data was being managed in his Outlook inbox. So he had a website, and when an order comes in, the website would send him an email, and he would just save that email. If the customer ever calls, he'd just go to Outlook and search for it. So it was like a lot of stuff going on. I kind of helped him during the first semester, helping him figure out how to identify his best-selling products, what to stock. But I kind of thought, okay, this is pretty cool. If this guy's having this problem, there's got to be a bunch of other businesses out there who have the same problem too, right? So in MBA program, there's this class taught by Rob Adams about how to launch a business, how to do market validation. So I got into that class and said that, okay, I'm going to use this idea and I'm going to pursue this further and see whether there is really any substance to this or this is just like one-off thing. That's where I met two of my co-founders, and they kind of liked that idea. They said that, okay, fine, let's take this. Let's do a lot of research on this. So we spent the entire semester cold calling customers. I think we would have called about like 100 or 150 different small businesses around the country, asking them, what are the biggest problems that you face? I know you have a good website, I know you seem to be selling good, but what is this one thing that is not running perfectly in your business, right? So we started off with the notion that they need like awesome inventory management, they need awesome forecasting things. But as we started talking to more and more people, we realized that their needs are even simpler. Like one of the absolute basic needs these guys had was, if I get 10 orders a day from my website, the way I actually ship them out is I would go to FedEx.com website, I would look at my email, start typing in the address there, and type in all the address details there, and then click a button and print out the label, put it on the box. In that translation, there was, as you type in, you would make them, if you make a mistake, the package goes to the wrong address, the customer is going to be pissed off. And if you don't give the right street address, FedEx is going to charge you like $10 penalty fee, right? So their problems were like absolutely very, very basic. So we said that, okay, we kind of, in a way, we pivoted. This is basically what we were doing, is what Steve Blank calls customer development. Very early stage in the year, just talking to as many people as we could. We started off with the hypothesis that they need this awesome inventory management thing, but we kind of pivoted, saying that, okay, that looks, they still have that need, but they're, that is not really the entry point for this business. You want to start with something even more basic. So we said that, okay, we wrote a business plan, saying that, okay, we'll start off with the label printing and some basic dropshipping features. But, and around that time, I think it was like second or third semester of MBA, and by that time we were sure that, okay, the market seems big enough. The amount of time we had spent on this, we knew that this is a good enough opportunity. The next big problem was that it's going to be a software company, but three of us were all MBAs, three co-founders, right? There's no one to write the software. So I have my degree is in engineering, I've written a lot of software before, but I'm not the guy who actually run a production quality web app. So we started looking around for who could be this right technical co-founder. We interviewed a bunch of guys, we actually spoke to a couple of UT undergrads, they were very interested, but it was not the right fit. One of them graduated and got a job with, I think it was Indeed.com, and he said that, okay, I don't think I'd rather go work on that because that's giving me more stability. With your company, I don't know whether anything's going to happen. really liked this one guy who was working for BazaarWise at that time, and he said that I'm really looking for an interesting startup. You guys seem like smart guys, and I think this idea is awesome. I'll work for you part-time. I do nights and weekends, and you just give me a small portion of that.
You met him through the speed game?
Yes.
One more.
So yeah, so he started working for us nights and weekends, and we kept building on the product. And pretty soon, I think it was probably September of last year. We actually got 4 customers to use it full time and start paying for it. That was a huge milestone for us. We actually had someone really paying, and I think the first customer actually paid us $289 a month. That was like, it was a huge deal for us to get that first payment, because everything till then, it was just PowerPoints and slide and just this notion that there is value in this. When we got the first check from this customer, we realized, okay, this is awesome. Now this really shows that there is value in this. And then after that, we kept fine-tuning it, and we released the product 1.0 around like March of last year. And we slowly started acquiring customers. We started looking for funding. We said that, okay, we should probably raise an angel round, because we were all out of business school. We were not taking any salary. We had huge student loans. And we really wanted to bring our technical co-founder on board full-time. And he couldn't work without salary. So we started going to all these different pitching events, and went to one of them. It was a local angel network event. We met with this guy who really liked what we were doing, and he said that I like you guys, I like your background, I like that you already have paying customers. I'm gonna make a bet on you guys, and we raised $600,000 angel round last year, and that was another huge landmark. That was the next set of validation. So that happened, I think it was in August, and things have been picking up ever since. We started spending a little bit more on marketing, on SEO, and that has really bumped our traffic and our sign-up rate. I think we were getting like less than 10 sign-ups a week. Now we're getting like somewhere close to 50 new sign-ups every week for our software, and that rate has been climbing. That also helped us hire, so we only had one guy writing code and 3 people trying to sell it. In a way, it was actually good to start that way, because it really constrained us to think hard about what features we're going to build in. Rather than trying to solve every single problem using a product feature, it forced us to go back and look at the whole market and see, is there a better way we can sell this product using different channels? So the 3 MBAs were like doing mostly sales and marketing. We started looking at channels, all the different ways we could push this product out. We really developed 2 good sales channels for us, mainly through partnerships, and we signed an awesome partnership about 7 months ago, and that really helped us increase our sign-up rate. And now, once we raised around, we said that, okay, fine, now let's actually hire one more developer. So we went and hired one more developer and a UX guy, and we wanted the UX guy up front, because we're targeting small businesses, the ease of use is extremely important. So, and now things have been picking up, and we're probably going to we're seeing a lot of interest from angels and early stage VCs. We're probably going to raise our Series A to really ramp this up to the next level. So I guess that's.
Do the MBAs outnumber the technical guys still?
Today, today it's equal.
We're even.
Yeah, we are even. We are actually hiring a next developer sometime in April. He's coming home away, so the balance is going to. So it's a good question, right? Look, where
are they
going
to find their technical people? Our voice? Oh, no way. I didn't tell you that, but.
You can't say Josh's voice?
Josh told us to come hire all the employees. Please sponsor our class next week.
So the question that Josh asked is a very interesting question, right? Why? One of our biggest problems from day one was that there were 3 MBAs and just 1 programmer.
That's why they didn't get into Capital Factory.
I didn't really want that too.
Now kind of we're looking at it going, they did it anyway without us.
The way I look at it, it's a huge deal. And to be honest, I have an MBA, so I think I can stage startup, that's not the kind of stuff you're going to be doing, right? The kind of stuff I was doing on day one was I was literally writing HTML code to build the website. I was debugging customer issues. I was like trying to get their data and like running a lot of different scenarios to understand like how can I get this guy going. It's all over the place. Do whatever it takes. So you cannot be thinking that I'm an MBA, so I'm just going to think about strategic aspects of this. So that's not, because in an early stage startup with just four guys, there is no strategy going on really. It's all about like you got to really figure out what's going to happen. So the way, and I'm really lucky to have my other MBA co-founders who thought the same way. So all of us, we stopped telling people that we are MBAs. Even now, if you go to our website, you won't see an about us page. And one of the reasons is that I am responding to customer support issues, and I kind of feel like I don't want them to know that the CEO is actually responding to my issues on why this XML file didn't load. That kind of could give a bad rap, so we decided that, okay, let's not come out in the open and like talk about like a CEO, CFO, and all that stuff. So the way but as we grow, the fact that we had MBAs turned out to be a really sweet deal, because we can deal with the lower level issues, but we can also deal with a lot of other complex issues. When we talk about these business partnerships, there's a lot of negotiation involved. It was really easy for us to do that. We didn't have a lot of advisors, but we kind of got a lot of that stuff. When we are talking to VCs, there's a lot of financial modeling involved. We don't have to go to someone else. We can do all that in-house. So as we grow, now we are reaching the stage where I've started seeing the benefit of having three generalist MBAs who was wearing all kinds of hats, but we can, rather than hiring like additional leadership, we can probably start hiring people who would really do the job, and we could migrate to different areas and start working. So start with MBA is not a great thing, but as you grow the company, it could work out in your advantage.
Alright, so thank you for doing that. I really appreciate hearing about it. I want to make sure we get time for a couple more questions. We're kind of squeezing this in, so of course we don't have a ton of time, but we'll get a couple in there.
What was the disappointment on your first customer?
So I'll tell you the whole story how we found the first customer. We started calling a lot of people, and one of the people who called, they posted this question on some forum about inventory management, and we just called them, and it turned out that they were in San Antonio, and we said, okay, fine, let's just drive down there. So me and my co-founders just drove down there, and they really liked us. They thought that, okay, we were smart people, we knew what we were doing. They said, okay, fine, I'll start using your software. And we actually built the software around their needs. We really knew what they were doing. We generalized it a little bit, but we knew exactly how they were running their business. We met them a couple of times, and we built the software around their needs. And it reached a point where they said that, yeah, I'm using this every day. And they said that, okay, we start paying you. That was the
Was that associated? Was there a tipping point from like, man, this is like hard, and we're banging our head against the wall, and then like, wait, it's working.
Yes.
I feel like I saw you guys go through that. I mean, exactly
when. So in the very early days, it was all about like, we would do whatever it takes. The way we came up with our pricing, right? So I don't know if any of you are in the MBA program. There's this professor, Jim Nolan. He talks about this notion called flinch pricing. The idea is like, someone asks you how much does it cost? You just come up with an arbitrary number. And if he says yes, you kind of like start putting parameters. Like, how much does it cost? We'll say like, okay, $1,000. Okay, per user. But if you say that, you say per month, and you keep adding stuff, and you say what? You know, the flinch pricing. So that's exactly what we did. We started coding. We had a rough idea. We had done some competitive analysis. We kind of knew what our competitors were charging. But there were a lot of other issues, because what we are in a space which is not really well defined. There are other people who are building similar software, but not exactly what we do. So there's no one-to-one comparison. So we had a rough notion, we kind of knew it was around $100. We started quoting $100. With some guys, we realized that they're making a whole lot more money. We started quoting much higher prices, and we kind of came up with price tiers, and that worked out. So I guess what I was going to say is that the very early days, we were like, the pricing was not on the website. We were trying to figure out, how do I convert this guy? We would give whatever discount it takes. We put a price he doesn't like it, we would just give them a discount, and we would actually build out features based on what they're asking about. So we never did custom development. We kind of knew that feature made sense for a lot of people. We would say, okay, fine, we don't have that, but that's the next feature we're going to build in about a month or so. Would you paying, and he would say, yes, I would commit to paying, and we'd use and add that feature. Now, the thing is, you got to be very careful if you pursue that strategy, because that's how you end up with feature bloat. So we kind of knew that this made sense. It's part of our feature roadmap, it's just that we were just pulling it ahead. So there was a lot of that scrambling going on. The big tipping point was that at one point, we realized that we don't have to build any more features. People just started using the product exactly the way it is. That's when we realized, okay, now we have a product market fit of sort, right? But to come back to that, a few months later, we realized that we don't have product market fit yet. And the way it happened was that, so the way our product works is if you're selling on like Shopify platform, you would use us. The way we would expand is that you would go to the next platform. We would go to Evolution or Magento, right? So we started really doing well on big commerce platform, and we said that, okay, fine, now we have a product market fit. Anyone who's not selling on big commerce could come and start using our software. It's awesome. Now it's just a matter of taking this and pushing into all the other channels. And we thought, it's just a matter of like, let's try to sell this hard. Pretty soon we realized that no, when you go to a new channel, it's almost there, but it's got to be polished a little bit more, you got to tweak a little bit more. So we use the term product channel fit a lot because our market is segmented into different channels. So right now we are going through that phase of like, okay, take the existing product and morph it a little bit so that it can fit into other channels. So that's, I think that's going to be a continuous evolution process. You want to balance that with the product becoming like too global.
One more.
What did you do in the summer between your first and second year? And after you graduated, did you work to support yourself now?
Cool. It's an awesome question because, so there were three of us, and we had kind of decided that we would start this company in the second semester, but we were not sure. And two of them got internships from like J&J and I think Dell, and they left for that. I almost got an offer from IBM, but I really thought hard and said that, okay, IBM is exactly the world that I came from, and I decided that I'm not going to go back. So I said, okay, I said no to that, and I just stayed at home and worked on this. I just kept calling people. So basically, I was just doing more market validation, just calling a lot more people and trying to understand how this product is going to be launched. And when we graduated, I think that was the second part of the question. There was no salary, so we just had to make do. I think one thing that helped us was that we had all worked for a while before. We had some savings, MBA program.